I will ask my co-chair, Dr. Preeti Vijayagunawardena, to introduce the first speaker.
Thank you, Geeta. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce, first of all, Dr. Jude Jayamaha. He obtained his MBBS from the University of Colombo in 2001 with honors and MD in medical virology in 2009. He's currently the lead and the consultant virologist at the National Influenza Center, Department of Virology Medical Research Institute. His main research interests include influenza and respiratory virus morbidity in children, cytomegalovirus disease in neonates and transplant patients. He's playing a big role these days with all these COVID problems, and we welcome you, Jude, and invite you to talk to us on the dilemmas in lab diagnosis.
Thank you, Cha, for that kind introduction. And first of all, let me thank you, the council, and of course the organization for taking the trouble amid of all these challenges at the so-called new normal of COVID-19, having this organization of a very valuable topic. With some consent from the organizing, the laboratory diagnosis, rather than dilemmas, I was thinking last few days, we had some questions, and of course we came across some questions from the clinical side as well as from some public health.
Yes.
So basically my outline would be virology and laboratory diagnosis, and what are the applications of laboratory diagnosis, tests, specimens, and issues, especially some recently asked questions based upon my theoretical and our Sri Lankan context, and few future directions. So just kind of a prelude, how accurate, these are some of the questions that we came across as laboratory experts. Does a negative specimen rule out a COVID-19 infection? Why can't we use rapid antibody test and antigen? Right, this was actually discussed in many forums, heated arguments, where they are in newspapers also, so much so that some unions actually make. And of course, this actually spilled over to the politics as well. So does it mean when a patient is becoming positive after initially negative, which happened 4 cases in Sri Lanka, and huge public concern was there whether this is a chronic infection or. And should, like, there were some inconclusive results or indeterminate results, and in that context, what will happen? So one, all these questions, or in fact, other questions sprout from during the practice, my basis is actually try to answer few. First of all, virology. It's coronavirus is actually the corona, the Latin word is actually the crown, head, or the crown actually. So there are some spikes, if I can move this. Yes, it's moving. So it's spikes. The spikes are actually proteins. And of course, it belongs to a coronaviridae family, where of course, in 2003, of course, this was actually came into the prominent picture because it's, we can call it a younger or elder brother actually, SARS coronavirus in 2003. That also, of course, originated in the same kind of geographic continent. And then, of course, 2013-14, Middle Eastern Respiratory Disease Syndrome, or in other words, MERS corona came up. And then, of course, there was huge attention. But of course, one has to mention that coronaviruses, of course, it has animal species, which I will have one slide share with you. But there are coronaviruses, human coronaviruses, so much so that we don't actually go into the detail. But because of this outbreak, we bought some kits. And when we did, there were something like 5% or 2% of human population were having infection. But those were mild, actually. So this is actually according to the severity. I have guessed down in case there are trainees in microbiology or in other fields. So this is actually this will be clear. So they are actually the evolution of coronaviruses is essentially a bat virus. You might have come across in general articles, it was descended by bat. Then of course, during that nearly 100 million years, right, it was evolved to other species, and primarily it is in a camel and civet cat, and it can spill over and have a sustained effect. We do not know still, even after the 8th month of this so-called disease, we do not know whether it is the origin still. But nevertheless, so moving on to the proper virology, in the sense the particular agent, SARS coronavirus, we have a spike protein. These are actually not important for a general or in fact a medical practitioner, but when we have a report or when we have a antibody report, it is important. That is the purpose of having this slide and spending few seconds on it. So this has spike protein called attachment. So neutralizing antibodies, especially in ELISA or chemiluminescence, should be targeted on this, and even immunochromatographic papers. I will elaborate it in few. Is there a timer going on here? Timer? You will be telling me. No worries. Okay, right. And nevertheless, so we have enveloped glycoprotein and N protein, which is not actually a neutralizing a part of the antibodies that is protected. So what are the indications of a laboratory test? Just for the having, you know, the PCR kit is there, and just for the sake of doing, we are not performing. There are several indications or application. So to begin with, SARS, before even now, say this was actually spread within actually a matter of a few weeks, kind of a global thing, but if it is a naive population or we have sera before, we can have an epidemiologic surveillance. And then, of course, when the infection is there, either in the individual or in the community, we can have a diagnosis, which, of course, our main resources are, and, of course, our main attention in either individual diagnosis or a group of cohortic diagnosis. And when the disease actually progress, either in an individual or in a hospital setup or in close communities, what is the stage? And then, of course, how do we monitor? How do we discharge the patient? So all these things, either microbiology or, in other words, other non-microbiological investigations or tests, so-called tests, come into play. And then, of course, recovery. And then after the recovery also, when so-called first wave or second wave or subsequent so waves, what is the extent of the spread in the community can be determined by laboratory tests. So I'll be dealing with those tests as well. So kind of another schematic presentation. So if you have a spectrum or actually the disease progression, so the incubation period we can monitor, or we can actually, if there's a one spread or one, just like Kanda Kuda or so many cohorts are there. So before the spread from other individuals, we can use some tests. And then of course, symptomatic illness, what are the tests that we use? De-isolation means when the patient is actually fit to discharge, or quarantine people, those who are asymptomatic also, can they go into the community? And of course, if there are so-called shedders, there's no chronic infection this particular given particular time, but so-called other persons are shedding in during the convalescence. So all these things are either understand or actually address by a laboratory sector. We will help the clinicians, the public health individuals, or in that matter, government to make policies and practices. So basically, molecular testing are the kind of the cornerstones, but one should not forget the supplementary role played by the serological testing. So the and of course, during the acute stage or during the hospital stay, there are certain other markers, especially the biochemical and hematological, will also play. But for the this particular presentation, I will be mainly concentrating on the first two. That also mainly the PCR. Just for the completeness sake, these are the other tests that can be, let's say, and we will not, because I'm not an expert on these areas, and of course, it is beyond our presentation. So virological tests, I will be mainly dealing with the virological tests. This is actually purposely I have mentioned the font size. So it is actually nucleic acid amplification are the main one, so-called NAT. And the molecular biology test or the nucleic acid test does not solely necessarily be PCR. Right? There are other tests, but of course we are mainly PCR. And hence, it is the main tool. I'll be dealing more time on that. So there are antigen tests, because now, for instance, like this was actually described in certain part of USA, even some politician, is influenza. So maybe that influenza mentality was there, and then of course there are antibody testing, rapid testing. And then of course traditionally viral culture, sequencing and antibody response. These are the five tests that I'll be talking, but only mainly talking about highlighted ones. So to diagnose an acute infection, molecular tests of course help, but there are some other dilemmas. Of course, there are negative, repeatedly negative in highly suspicious patients. Then of course we can go for antibody testing, and of course seroprevalence studies also very important for to the extent, the spread of the extent. So a test, of course, and then of course we are going to the specimens. So basically it's a respiratory tract we are actually dealing with, but not conclusively. Upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract, we can divide it according to the anatomical one. And of course, it comes because of the convenience, for the convenience of the patient, and of course, mass scaling, and of course, to the healthcare worker who obtains. Upper respiratory tract samples are the most specimens that universally actually subjected as tests. So lower respiratory tracts are also there. In few minutes, we will be discussing sensitivity and the specificity as well. And of course, stools, blood, and some autopsy samples has been performed, including many laboratories in Sri Lanka as well. So what is the specimen type that yield, highest yield? Bronchial alveolar lavage, BAL stands for bronchial alveolar lavage, sputum, nasopharyngeal swab, oropharyngeal swab as the descending order with that percentage. So when we combine nasopharyngeal swab and oropharyngeal swab and try to increase the yield up to a 70%. A sputum, of course, is preferred, but a sputum, of course, I think my next speaker or maybe those physicians know that every patient is not, sometimes, of course, asymptomatic as well, and even symptomatic patient may be not producing sputum. MRI has done 10 sera and 5 urine for real-time PCR, but none of them actually yield PCR result in a non-respiratory sample, but of course this is a very small number. And then of course, after specimens, we need to know what is the collection time, because time is so important, especially when you're exposed or a particular community is exposed, and when of course, when you're going to discharge from the quarantine center. So molecular testing, the symptoms are in light shaded area, and the virus detectable is in that green, the blue area. Sorry. So before starting symptoms, of course, one can have it, but of course, our challenge is, including Sri Lanka, we have asymptomatic patients, so called persons or patients. So then, of course, this slide is useful, either testing those who are negative or maybe so-called where we cannot explain a positive PCR result with epidemiological or any other link. So antibodies will also come to play. Antibodies will be there from 3 to 6 days. There's another slide for that. And IgG antibody will appear around 7 to 10 days. So this is important when we interpret the results. So very basically, PCR is actually polymerase. It stands for polymerase chain reaction. It's an enzymatic one. It's a cyclical thing, and it's a reaction. So as the name denotes, so there's a cyclical thing which goes to 45 cycles or 34 cycles, and a very even one molecule is actually amplified to a very high number, million or sometimes actually kind of a thumb of mathematics. Two copies to start with, it will increase to 2 billion copies. And we are amplifying a highly specific area for that particular virus. Even coronavirus, SARS coronavirus 1, SARS coronavirus 2, or in the matter if there's another very close related one, but after sequencing, after the first few weeks of the epidemic, WHO and all other public domain shared the whole genome sequencing, and of course we are targeting not only actually SARS coronavirus, any other ones. For instance, Escherichia coli Enterohemorrhagica 0157. We can highly specifically, that particular species have a highly specific order of the particular nucleotide. So it's highly specific that we are amplifying. So this is a kind of a schematic presentation. I will not go into detail, but we'll take the essence of PCR. Highly specific region is multiplied into a very high copy number. And then, of course, the sensitivity, we increase the sensitivity to a greater extent. So then again, that's why I initially highlighted the slide. So there are certain protein, because this is important when we have either a controversial report or unexplainable report. What is the target that we use? That, of course, it is mainly for us, but I will not want to go into detail. But if you come across in a research paper or in that matter, some other news item. So the WHO criteria are there, CDC criteria are there. Sometimes, of course, the laboratory, they can decide own criteria by looking into the genomic and all. So in Sri Lanka, we use both actually, CDC and WHO, and we prefer many targets, at least two or more targets, not one target. We increase the sensitivity. So the so-called targets. So this is actually the another flow, sampling, nucleic acid extraction, real-time PCR, and then of course amplification. So interpretation is also important because it's a bit complex one. But of course, only three results are possible, are detected, or positive, negative, or inconclusive. So real-time PCR, negative, suspicious, high, we use if the clinician or if the public health person say that, say spouse or very close proximity, same room, we will actually repeat it with preferably lower respiratory tract for obvious reasons that I had described previously. So what are the positive rates? Obviously, according to the particular previous graph, it's not a Gaussian curve as such. The virus will actually rise, but there's a steep fall. So after day 10, sometimes day 7, day 10, it will reduce to 50% of chance. So then, of course, what are the other possibilities? Especially we come across a negative PCR report where we highly suspect that the patient either contact is positive. So there could be vulnerabilities. It's not false positive or in fact false negative, especially false negative. There are other reasons. For instance, even for full blood count, or in that matter, if you have a very simple hemoglobin level, there are certain parameters that proper tube, like fasting, proper fasting. There are other factors that will in effect or will have a direct effect on the result. So PCR being a very complex procedure, there are many steps. Traditionally in biochemistry, we divided into pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical, but here main areas are the pre-analytical and analytical. So general factors, of course, I will not go into detail, but just a listing. So lack of identification, of course, because yesterday from Jayewardenepura, we received 400 samples, and none of them were labeled, but only like 46, 56, and all there. So some were submerged in the sense when the ice was coming. So maybe when they collect a lot of samples, it's very difficult. So that also a challenge nevertheless. So what are the analytical factors? So previously the general factors. So there are analytical factors, again starting from what is the sample, how long it has been stayed outside, and of course whether what are the primers and what is the laboratory structure, what are the controls that we're using, and all these come into play of the final result. So PCR result, as I mentioned, this particular one is a qualitative one because there are other certain PCR that give a value like cytomegalovirus, BK virus, but here, whether it's detected and whether it's not detected, the target or the targets. And of course, in between, very rarely it comes inconclusive, right? And of course, this is kind of a graph where we actually have the real-time PCR, it actually having a graph. Right. So, bit about the cycle threshold also. There are certain cycle threshold that they actually mentioned. So, this is actually the cycle threshold that actually it has gone, because cycle threshold has been included in a recent circular, and it has actually led to a bit confusion. And because cycle threshold is not usually given like a qualitative PCR, quantitative PCR, and there are no clinical studies to guide for the management as such. So little bit of viral sequencing and viral culture, only viral sequencing is there to determine kind of a whether mutations are there or what is the serotype or the genotype. So whatever the genotype, it's the same at the moment, the severity. So serological tests are basically neutralizing assays, chemiluminescence assays, and ELISA, which is widely available. Neutralization assay is the gold standard, but these assays are standardized against the gold standard. And of course, as I mentioned, point of care tests are the main rapid ones. So this is actually a nice one from BMJ. I think it's in maybe in this particular list. So enzyme immunoassays have a high 84%, and lateral flow test, so-called immunofluorescence, the rapid test has very low result, and of course the last one being the chemiluminescence assay. So when it comes to Sri Lanka, Sri Lanka, of course we have given ELISA assays has been locally validated, and we need to already serve zero surveys and patient discharge criteria are been incorporated, and we are awaiting for the government sector for more assays. And there are chemiluminescence machines that we have been donated for the high throughput one. So I think this, of course, you can have it in the internet. I will leave this slide. Bit another 30 seconds of the future diagnostics, because future diagnostics are actually PCR is also at the point of care testing now. It is in the USA market, where actually when you come either drive in or actually in the hospital. So a little bit calorimetric testing, I mean no machine in the sense, no sophisticated machine, staff is less needed, and it is in the market, and most probably it will cross the ocean, the Atlantic Ocean. And this is another novel technique, another calorimetric color change method. Thank you for your attention. I would like to tribute all healthcare service and security personnel in this so-called COVID war. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Jude, and that was so interesting. I'm sure there'll be a surge of questions, but we leave it for the last. I just want to remind the audience that this is a joint program of the Medicinal Drug Committee and the Ethics Committee of the Sri Lanka Medical Association. I invite Professor Geeta to introduce the next speaker.
Yeah, the next speaker is Professor Chandanie Wanigatunge. She is a specialist in internal medicine and is the chair professor of pharmacology of the Faculty of Medical Sciences, University of Sri Jayewardenepura. She is also the chairperson of the Ethics Review Committee of the SLMA and a member of the Ethics Committee of the SLMA. She is also the chairperson of the Forum for Ethics Review Committees in Sri Lanka and is an international survey for the Forum of Ethics Review Committees in Asia and Western Pacific. Over to you, Chandanie.
Thank you very much, Madam, for that kind introduction, and thank you very much for the SLMA Council for the invitation. My presentation is titled Prescribing as We Go, and I'd like to take you through the treatment of COVID-19, what we did with the key selected medicines, the challenges and ethical issues that we faced when trying to get the guidelines out, and a few thoughts about what I think as professional development beyond COVID, which is part of this Congress. So in December 2019, we almost knew nothing. 25th of January, we had our first patient. Well, it was a Chinese national. And on the 19th of February, we thought COVID went back. But by 11th March, we had our first patient in Sri Lanka. And that's when things started to change. We knew that it was now with us, and we needed to do something. But of course, by that time, we knew that this was a coronavirus, which had some similarities to SARS and MERS, and that it causes a respiratory infection, which is fairly mild and self-limiting in the majority, which is what we've been seeing all this time, severe in 20%, and with a high mortality in 5%. But what was most alarming was that it transmits very rapidly, and we knew that something had to be done fairly soon. So obviously, because it's a virus, you need antivirals, if that's possible. We knew that it caused some inflammatory changes, something like ARDS, due to a cytokine storm, so we needed anti-inflammatory agents, and of course, various drugs to manage complications because it caused many multi-system involvement. Because time was short, people were looking at repurposing or repositioning the medicines that were already in place. Now, repurposing or repositioning is simply taking medicines that are known to act on similar parasites or pathogens and trying to see whether it will work in this particular organism. The advantage of repositioning is you can skip some of the steps in this clinical trials and so on, because it's already in place, people have been using, we know what it does in the majority of the cases. So repositioning was what the world was looking at. So with repositioning, there were three drugs that came up very actively. The first one was chloroquine, which was used for many years for malaria and thereafter for various rheumatoid diseases. And then by extension, hydroxychloroquine, which did show some benefit in vitro. And then they also looked at another drug called remdesivir, which was used for Ebola virus. And then they found that these three compounds, or that is chloroquine, and by extension hydroxychloroquine, and remdesivir were effective in vitro. So that was the data we had at that time. And with that, the Clinical Management Committee of the Ministry of Health regarding for COVID-19 met on the 19th of March to decide on the treatment guidelines, or what should we give to our patients. And over the next few minutes, I'm going to take you through what we did and take you through what we thought of at that time so that you understand why certain things were happening. So when we came first, we knew that there was some evidence to say that hydroxychloroquine reduced infection and spread. And because it attenuates the cytokine production, by extension then it should reduce the cytokine storm. And of course, compared to chloroquine, the effects were seen at a lower half maximal concentration, that's EC50, which meant that the toxic effects would then be less. So that was a good drug to use. We knew what it was like. And there was data. There were two papers on the 19th of March when we met that we looked at. One was the position statement from the Chinese, where there was no original data for us to assess. They just said that it is effective, had been used in over 100 patients, and the Chinese were recommending the use of chloroquine. Then there was this paper by Didier Rao, coming from the Marseille group, which said that giving hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin was beneficial. Of course, there were issues, methodological issues with that paper, but those two papers were there for us to show that there is some benefit when we use hydroxychloroquine for COVID-19. Then, despite not having good in vitro data and some controversial claims on their efficacy for SARS or MERS, the other drug that we discussed on the 19th was favipiravir. Now, favipiravir, by that time, again, there were two papers. Interestingly, one was published in an engineering journal, which showed that there was some reduction, some improvement in the clinical recovery rate when favipiravir was given. But of course, this was not a drug available in Sri Lanka at that time. It was not a registered product. So these were the four documents we had at that time to make our decisions. And of course, favipiravir was not even marketed in Japan or thought of as effective for COVID-19 at that time. So with that data, we recommended the use of chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine for all symptomatic PCR positive people in Sri Lanka. So the DG's document came out on the 25th as a circular, but before that the EPID unit gave our recommendations online. So we said, okay, give it for those who are PCR positive and symptomatic, but we did not recommend it for chemoprophylaxis, nor did we recommend hydroxychloroquine for those with suspected COVID-19 or those awaiting confirmation of their diagnosis. So it was only for symptomatic PCR positive people that we recommended hydroxychloroquine. Over the ensuing months, we looked at another drug which was showing quite a lot of promise in vitro, that is remdesivir. Remdesivir, the first case of coronavirus in the United States, was given remdesivir with a lot of other medicines, so it showed some benefit. Then towards mid-April, there were papers coming out saying, yes, it does help in those who have SARS-CoV-2, particularly those who have severe illness, that is those receiving oxygen. And they had observed certain benefits in these people. This compassionate use of remdesivir was the only thing that was available at that point, because the drug was being held by Gilead, that was the country company that was manufacturing it. And the only way you could get a drug at that point was by using it from Gilead. And we did try to contact Gilead without much success. But by end May, United States FDA gave approval for emergency use of remdesivir in patients with severe COVID-19. Of course, by 22nd May, there were better publications coming out, again, preliminary report of people treated with COVID-19, showing that remdesivir was superior to placebo in shortening the time of recovery in hospitalized patients with COVID-19. Those were the three antivirals that we looked at. The other drug that we looked at was steroids. As I said, there was an inflammatory component, so we wanted to know whether there was any evidence for the use of steroids. Again, there were pre-publication data, again, as much as early March, which showed that early low-dose, short-term application of methylprednisolone was associated with some improvement. But there were a lot of other negative comments coming out with the use of steroids, and all the international guidelines coming from the WHO, the Royal Colleges of Physicians, the ICMR India, all recommended against the routine use of steroids. And we left it open for the clinicians treating COVID-19 patients to decide when or if they want to use steroids and what to do. But it was not an outright recommendation coming from the committee for the reasons that I mentioned. But a couple of days ago, 17th July to be precise, there was a report published as an original article in the NEJM which showed that dexamethasone helped people with COVID-19. Again, a preliminary report. It showed that the 28 days mortality was reduced in those who had severe COVID, but not among those who were not receiving respiratory support. So again, in a limited subset, there is now more evidence to say that steroids are effective. Of course, there are another heap of drugs, which we kept on looking at every morning when we met during the COVID lockdown period. We looked at zinc, we looked at so many other medicines. As you can see, the list is exhaustive. But we didn't actually recommend any of those because the evidence at that point was not so robust. So as of today, we know that hydroxychloroquine with or without azithromycin has no proven benefit. The data is still not that robust for us, and that it had been taken off the WHO solidarity trial as well. We know that favipiravir's efficacy has not been established. Remdesivir has shown some benefit in those with severe COVID-19, and that dexamethasone has also shown some benefit, if given at the appropriate time, in those with severe illness. The efficacy and safety of convalescent plasma has not been established up until now. And for zinc supplementation, again, we need some more trials. So then, that's what we looked at from March up until now, and we keep on looking at data as they come out to decide on how best Sri Lanka should proceed. So what were the challenges that we faced, and what were the ethical issues that we encountered as we went on, which is the next part of my presentation? We saw information coming out in unprecedented numbers, and it was available for everybody, which was a good thing. All the journals were giving out their data free. As you know, most of us cannot access most of the top-end journals from Sri Lanka, but this was one instance where everything was available for anyone to access. Apart from that, we had pre-publication data and also journal pre-proof available. But as an ethical issue, we saw people coming out trying to capture the attention. It was such a big problem that for somebody to say, I have got a treatment, was enough for them to gain popularity, if you want to call it popularity. And that is what Rao did with his thing. Rao's first paper was accepted. The second time when he said, okay, I'm replicating my data, again from Marseille, not from any other place. And when other people were questioning his findings, he went straight to the press. And that is how Rao's second paper came out, and it was published only in their website. Again, accessible to everybody. But of course, as you can see, the one that I have put at the bottom, the med treatment IV, is where any author can publish their publications without any peer review. And MedTrib itself says these are not peer reviewed. These should not be used for decision making, nor should they be used for clinical decision making. But despite that, we had no option but to look at them for clinical decision making, and for treatment guidelines. That was a huge challenge we faced. What were we going to use? Of course, he was helped by many others. Across the globe, we had our own people helping him. But then it did take up. So therefore, there were lots of people using hydroxychloroquine for treatment as well as prophylaxis, despite very limited evidence. We also saw, much more than what we normally see, people looking at this information extremely critically. And I can remember my colleague, Dr. Ananda Wijewickrama, who looked at Rao's paper and said, no, I don't like the way they have put people, you know, into this benefit part. So it's not only elsewhere, it's here as well in Sri Lanka. We were looking at every little thing to see what we could find. So right across the globe, people were criticizing every single paper that came out, showing that there are problems in the data that was coming out. So the quality of the data, the quality of clinical trials that were coming out were questioned in a big way across the globe. Sri Lanka was no exception. The important thing is people were trying to give out data as quickly as possible because this was a problem. But by doing that, they were cutting corners, and then when somebody questions, and if you look at most of the papers that I just showed you, the comments that come subsequently, the authors have accepted. Because then they say, yes, this is an interim analysis. We will be looking at it later when we do the full publication. Now, the interim data has a possibility of changing with the full publication. And with that, the management decisions will also change. So that was a challenge that we faced, not only us, the rest of the world as well. We saw articles being retracted at a rate. And these were two of the highest journals that any one of us could even aspire to get an article into, NEJM and The Lancet. And they just had to take their papers down very quickly when the people pointed out, saying that, look, your publication is flawed. There is data which is not true, which showed that even the journals were actually trying to give out things without going through their usual peer review process. And anybody who has submitted to a journal will know how long it takes even to get the first acknowledgement, leave alone anything else regarding corrections. So we saw that. This had other implications. This was one instance where people are now asking, okay, whom can we trust if we can't trust the preprints? If we can't trust the journal publications, where do we go for data? And that was a huge challenge. That is something that we saw right across during this pandemic, which was unprecedented compared to the earlier problems that we face. One of the biggest problems we faced was applying this data to Sri Lanka, because we had a small number of patients. Our patients were mainly people with mild disease, and many did not have the complications that the other countries had. Most of the papers were actually talking about people with severe COVID-19, and ours were just mild or asymptomatic to a large majority. So we had this big problem about, should we give HCQ to all PCR positive patients, or should we just stop with only those who are symptomatic? Or should we give HCQ at all? And from 19th March to today, we have been debating this question every single day when we meet through Zoom or we haven't met physically, but through Zoom, asking ourselves, should we give HCQ? Should we take it off our treatment guidelines? The next problem we had was not recommending HCQ for prophylaxis. And although we said no for prophylaxis, within days, India's ICMR said, yes, give it for those who had high exposure and high risk for COVID-19 because they have been exposed very clearly. That triggered a wave of emails among our own people because it was worrying. And if you look at the subject of that email that all of us in the committee got, along with so many other calls, it says, Indians have got it right. So have we got it right? And that was one of the biggest problems that we had to face. Our reasons for not giving were very simple. We knew that giving HCQ without any monitoring may have cardiac problems because we know it prolongs QT. We didn't want to give a combination of HCQ and azithromycin for the same reason, plus because azithromycin is a reserve medicine for pneumonia. We didn't want to give it widely without any monitoring. But it was heartening to note that even within India, there were issues, and Indians themselves were questioning the ICMR's decision to give hydroxychloroquine for prophylaxis. But now there are publications coming out to say that giving hydroxychloroquine as prophylaxis does not give the protection that we expect it to give. It's wise, it's very easy to be wise at hindsight, but when we were doing it, these were the issues that plagued us. One of the other major problems we faced was this Avigan or Favipiravir. Despite with the lack of evidence, we had a stock of favipiravir coming into the country, and now we had this drug sitting in Sri Lanka. Are we going to give it or not was our problem. We contacted the PMDA through the NMRA to find out their stand, and they said, no, there is no evidence to show that it is effective. So we have still not said okay to that stock of favipiravir to be used. So it's still sitting there in the country. Globally, we saw that there was no justice. There was no fair play. It was the power of the mighty. Of course, you can't blame the United States. They are the epicenter now. But still, we found that all the medicines were being stockpiled. Not only in the United States, even in Sri Lanka, people were stockpiling hydroxychloroquine, so much so that the NMRA had to give a directive saying, don't issue any hydroxychloroquine to anybody without a valid prescription. Again, there was no justice or fair play, and that's a major ethical and a prescribing challenge to anybody using this. So my last slide is very briefly about professional development beyond COVID-19. What do I think? These are my data. This is what I think, so it's not substantiated with any evidence. I think one of the biggest challenges we had, and if we are going to go beyond this epidemic, we need to develop our ability to evaluate the data that is hitting us from every direction in a scientific manner, and to get out what is needed and to use it effectively. We should know how to make a rational judgment irrespective of the pressures and in times of crisis. It's also important to learn to trust and accept the local experts. It was a bit disheartening at times when everything was there and then the local experts say, look, do this. We get somebody saying, why don't you call so-and-so and find out whether that's the same thing. I'm not sure how, if you evaluate scientifically, whether the local experts can give anything different from the other experts, especially when the local experts have the local ground knowledge and what is happening as a ground situation. It's extremely important to maintain professional and scientific integrity, and that's the hardest thing you can do in a pandemic. And if we are going to go beyond this, we do need to know how we can maintain our integrity, both professionally and scientifically. And of course, to ensure accountability and transparency in everything that we do so that it is accepted. And every single recommendation that we sent to the DG from the committee was backed with whatever evidence that we had. We had a document that we made, which said, okay, these are the documents that we looked at, and based on that, this is why we are recommending it. So if somebody wants it, we were willing to give that data. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, I cannot put it better than what I have in this NEJM article. Basically, what it's saying is that pandemic will leave us with lots of memories, most of them unpleasant, but at the end of the day, as far as medicines are concerned, we need to trust our time-tested approaches to clinical trial evidence and drug evaluation, rather than cutting corners and resorting to appealing yet risky quick fixes. Damage to the country's medication assessment process and the public's respect for it should not be part of the pandemic's legacy, unquote. And ladies and gentlemen, I think Sri Lanka has done quite well as far as the medicines are concerned with regard to COVID-19. Thank you.
Thank you, Chandanie, for that very enlightening and excellent presentation. The next speaker is Dr. Ananda Wijewickrama. Ananda graduated in 1991 from the Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo, and I must say that I had the pleasure of teaching him pharmacology, Ananda.
Yeah.
He obtained MD Sri Lanka from PGIM in 1998, MRCP UK, FRCP London, FCCP from the Ceylon College of Physicians in 2009. He is working as the consultant physician at the National Institute of Infectious Diseases, formerly known as IDH, Colombo, since 2003. And he's also an external lecturer and examiner in the faculties of medicine and the member of the National Medicines Regulatory Authority of Sri Lanka. Over to you, Ananda. And he will speak on challenges in treatment.
Thank you, madam, for your kind introduction. And I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. I consider this as a great privilege. I'm going to talk about the challenges in treatment of COVID-19 infection. And I think I have another challenge because my previous speaker was Chandanie, who gave an excellent talk. So I have to match. I don't think I can match that, but I'll try. As we know, the first patient was detected in Sri Lanka on 26th of January. That was a Chinese national. And our first local patient was detected on 10th of March. Since then, there had been 2,763 cases up to now. That was up to yesterday. And out of this, 2,094 patients had been discharged and 11 deaths. If you look at the historical accounts of estimates of this illness, on 3rd of March, the WHO estimated as the disease as having a 3.4% mortality rate. On February 4th, the China reported that it has a mortality rate of 2.1% nationwide. In Hubei province, it was 3.1, and in Wuhan, it was 4.9, sorry. And then it increased to, by 20th of February, it increased to 3.8 nationwide in China. And then there had been studies providing a tentative mortality rate of around 3%. But the inpatient death rate was quite high, amounting to about 15%. And on the average duration hospital stay was from the onset of symptoms was about 2 weeks. By now, as of yesterday, we had more than 15 million of cases and more than 600,000 deaths. Out of this total number of cases, 10 countries contribute to 1/3 of the total number of cases. USA heading the list, then Brazil and India. And within the last 24 hours, another 50,000 or 41,000, to be precise, had been added to India's total. We had many challenges when we come to treat these patients. One of the biggest challenges was the fear. This was an article published by the BBC, where they said, "Rarely has the threat of disease occupied so much of our thinking. For weeks, almost every newspaper has stories about the coronavirus pandemic on its front page, radio, and the TV programs have back-to-back coverage on the latest death tolls. And depending on who you follow, social media platforms are filled with frightening statistics, practical advices, or gallows of humor. This is true for our country also, our media and our social media as well. What are the results of this? In the health sector, in hospitals, we saw patients are being refused to be seen when the suspicion of COVID was there. And certain in other patients and other instances, even when the suspicion was not there, it was refused to attend to the patient until a negative PCR result was available. Then there were a lot of unnecessary usage of personal protective equipment. And then people were employing measures to sort of distance patient management by partitioning the wards, by communicating through various devices, microphones, and using robotic trolleys to distribute food and medicines, etc. So the nursing care and the medical care was provided by a distant method. And then many equipments were also produced to cater this so-called need. But a bigger challenge for clinicians was the unknown pathogenesis of the disease. We saw a lot of pulmonary complications leading to hypoxia and respiratory failure. When we do CT scans or chest X-rays, they show multiple shadows, worsening shadows, and patients are getting bad, going into respiratory failure. And this resulted in attempts of various modes of ventilation, having more ICU beds with ventilatory facilities, and that compromised other needs in the health sector, needs for COVID patients as well. And a large amount of ICU ventilators were being produced. This is one of the X-rays of a patient who was, when he was becoming hypoxic, And 3 days later, you can see the whole lung was, both lungs were more or less gone. Did the x-ray of another patient when he started to get hypoxic, and again, 3 days later, you can say how much the whole lungs were involved. So this created a panic and a fear, and that created a challenge. And production of ventilators went up. This is how it went up in the US. In 2019, the average monthly production, or rather weekly production, was 700, and it went up to 7,000 per week. And then in the UK, a consortium was formed with people from aerospace, automotive, and medical sector to produce ventilators. The challenges were so much. But then other things needed for larger number of patients were probably forgotten. Then comes the biggest challenge, the lack of treatment. As Chandanie quite nicely put that, we had many discussions in our Zoom meetings. In fact, I think by now we had more than 75 meetings from, I think, 15th of March. And we had a lot of discussions. We went through the things in details, we argued, but finally we came to conclusions and gave our recommendations. And that was a learning exercise for me. This is how the, from 26th of January up to 8th of March, the number of trials went up. Number of trials related to COVID went up. The total number during that period itself amounting to 382. Out of this, 108 were new trials on medications from Western medicine, and another 98 were from traditional Chinese medicine. This only up to 8th of March. After that, I'm sure there are many more trials. And various antiviral agents were tested, antimalarial drugs, antibiotics, antiparasitics, then nonspecific anti-inflammatory drugs, immunosuppressive treatment, kinase inhibitors, monoclonal antibodies, and many other miscellaneous drugs were tested during this period. But still, the challenge persists with what to treat. Currently, the FDA has not approved any drug for the treatment of COVID-19. However, it says, this is the statement from NIH, USA, an array of drugs approved for other indications as well as multiple investigative agents are being studied for the treatment of COVID in several hundred clinical trials around the globe. Some drugs can be accessed through emergency use authorization, expanded access programs, or compassionate use mechanisms. That's for US. So the NIH, probably which gives a very detailed recommendation on treatment, says for asymptomatic and pre-symptomatic infection or mild illness, there's no treatment. They don't need treatment. And when it comes to moderate illness, severe illness, or critical illness, still they say the same. They say clinicians should refer to antiviral therapy and table 2A and immune-based therapy. They have given the tables because there are no one drug is recommended for the condition, or only drugs are recommended for various situations only. As Chandanie mentioned, remdesivir is one of the drugs which shows some promising effects. This multinational randomized controlled trial of remdesivir versus placebo in hospitalized patients showed in its preliminary report, in patients with COVID-19, remdesivir reduced the time to clinical recovery. The benefit of remdesivir was most apparent in hospitalized patients who were not intubated but who require supplementary oxygen. So even that is not for everybody, and we have to wait for the full report to see the actual benefit of this. Then there had been two other trials on remdesivir. Again, the interpretation of first one is the hospitalized patient with COVID-19 who were not on mechanical ventilation or ECMO, remdesivir treatment for 5 or 10 days has similar clinical benefit, that they were checking the dose. And then other one which was done in China, they said there was no difference in time to clinical improvement, 28-day mortality or rate of viral clearance between remdesivir treated and placebo-treated patients. So again, the findings are probably contradicting. So we had to wait for the full report. Coming to dexamethasone, a preliminary unpublished analysis from a large multicenter randomized open label trial, which is the recovery trial done in the UK, showed those randomized to dexamethasone 6 mg had reduced mortality within 28 days of enrollment compared to those who received the standard of care. So dexamethasone seems to be working on a group of patients with severe illness. However, I would like to draw your attention to these numbers here. In the control group, the death rate was 21.6. And in the drug group, the test group, and the placebo, or the standard of care group, the death rate was 24.6. So almost 1/4 of the people in that group have died. So you can see that they have taken a very extreme group of patients for this study. So whether we can generalize these findings is another question. On the other hand, there are other small studies done on dexamethasone, short courses of dexamethasone, which have shown potential harm. So these findings we have to interpret carefully when we see all the evidence. So the challenge remains. As Chandanie mentioned, we decided to start our patients on hydroxychloroquine with limited evidence. At that time, there was another paper which said from China, preliminary results from more than 100 patients have demonstrated that chloroquine phosphate is superior to the control treatment in inhibiting the exacerbation of pneumonia, improving the lung imaging findings, promoting virus negative conversion, and shortening the disease course. So that such limited evidence, even though the evidence was limited, made us to recommend hydroxychloroquine. But then since then, there had been many other evidence. But I personally feel hydroxychloroquine was badly treated. As mentioned, in one study which was widely publicized, it was combined with HCQ was combined with azithromycin. As we know, it can worsen the prolonged QT interval. So obviously, they had a higher death rate. And then there's this infamous Lancet study, which was withdrawn later, showing a high mortality rate with HCQ. And when it came out, they have done a study of 90,000 cases, looked highly impressive. But then when we analyzed the study carefully, we saw the gaps there, and then we saw the withdrawal of the study. Then there was another study in Brazil where they used high dose HCQ. Obviously, with high doses, we would expect to see more cardiac events with that. And the huge publicity was given for these studies. The result was the solidarity study stopped. Solidarity study done by the WHO stopped using HCQ. Recovery study later stopped HCQ. They analyzed their own data and they said there is no benefit, so they stopped that arm. And still some evidence are coming for hydroxychloroquine also. This is a small retrospective study, not small, done on 2,541 patients in the US, where they concluded there is some benefit and suggested prospective trial. So we continue to use hydroxychloroquine, not because we are analyzing our own data, but probably because we are more confident in the drug, because which we have been using, that we have been using for years for malaria. That is probably one reason. And then some of the issues, challenges seems to be resolving. We saw the X-ray changes, we attributed those to pneumonia, but when we did repeated X-rays, we saw the shadows are changing. It's just not like typical pneumonia. The shadow you saw today will be completely at a different place when you do the X-ray in 3 days' time. So with that, the possibility of, and with other analysis of the oxygenation and other blood parameters, this theory of thromboembolism came. So it is now thought the thromboembolism is causing a major part in the illness. So we are assessing the patients for the possibility of venous thromboembolism, and now it is in some centers, patients are getting a low molecular weight heparin if the patients are having higher risk, again, without much evidence. And then there had been changes in ventilator strategies. Prone ventilation, which we generally do only in severe patients with ARDS, is becoming a routine thing in these patients, and that shows a remarkable improvement in these patients' oxygenation. And then it is recommended even for non-ventilated patients to have self-prone position, to be in the self-prone position when they are mild to moderately ill, and that improves the oxygenation of these patients. The changes with the positioning was remarkable, and I am sure that helped the recent lowering of death rates, at least partly attributed to this change of these ventilator strategies. And in addition, the non-invasive ventilation is promoted now. So we are coming out of this ICU the ventilatory requirement, and we are looking at other options for these patients now. In Sri Lanka, the cases, even though not high, we had outbreaks first at naval camp and then at Kandakadu Rehabilitation Center. And still, our case numbers are low, so it is more or less at becoming sort of static, this up to yesterday. However, this has led to other problems, becoming new challenges, or maybe it's the old challenges is persisting. The persistent fear is there still among healthcare workers. So still there's a lot of unnecessary use of personal protective equipments, body spraying. But on the other hand, there's a complacency among public. And I believe for this, the political leaders and media are largely responsible. We see large public gatherings not adhering to health measures like physical distancing. If anybody saw yesterday's news in many channels, it was shown how a patient who, by the way, escaped from our hospital, was given full kit of PPE to wear, which was unnecessary, and how the three-wheeler driver was body sprayed, which is totally unnecessary. But on the other hand, the same news item showed how the public were gathered to greet political leaders without maintaining social distancing. So these are the challenges, and that is going to be a bigger challenge because still our knowledge on pathogenesis is little, and we don't have a proven treatment, and even though many trials are still underway, the disease is spreading rapidly worldwide, and if we haven't come to the threshold of that spread, and when it exceeds a certain threshold, it spread like wildfire. That's what we see in places like USA, India, and so on. So this complacency in general public is of great concern. Thank you.
Thank you, Ananda, for enlightening us on how you have been treating patients at IDH. I know that you have done a lot of work. I'm sure you must be very tired because now we are also having the dengue. So anyway, best of luck to you. So now it's question time.
Yeah, there's one question which has come in from Professor Priyadarshini Galapati. Isn't the evidence of hydroxychloroquine in patients not having severe disease still lacking? Come, I think you should come. Why don't you all come?
If I may answer that question. So yes, it is lacking, and that's, as I said, one of our biggest problems on how to use it. Evidence in this sort of a situation is a problem because we don't have time. And if you really look at how things have been happening in the past, even after living for decades with dengue, we still don't have any evidence for any effective treatment. And that's how a virus behaves. So for hydroxychloroquine, yes, evidence is lacking. We would like to see much more robust evidence for asymptomatic patients and even for symptomatic patients. But we are waiting our data, which Ananda and the group are analyzing, which will probably give us some more insight as to how we have done as regards to hydroxychloroquine in people with mostly mild disease.
Yeah, I agree with Chandanie that Priyadarshini, the evidence is lacking. But as I said, because when we started, we had limited evidence. Then there were evidence against and for that for hydroxychloroquine. But we continue to use maybe because, as I said, we are confident about the drug rather than about the efficacy of the drug. And we are waiting for more data. Yes.
Any other questions?
So well done, Dr. Ananda Wijewickrama, Chandanie, Dr. Jayamaha, the whole team, and also the PHI, then especially the nurses and everybody. Well done. So I want to know, I'm sure there are ongoing clinical trials about patients receiving hydroxychloroquine, those who are not receiving combination of azithromycin and hydroxychloroquine. Possibly those trials are being done at the National Institute of Infectious Disease.
Madam, at the moment, we are giving hydroxychloroquine to all symptomatic patients. So what we are analyzing actually is there are two groups of patients we can separate. Those who had the hydroxychloroquine early in the illness, within, say, 4 to 5 days of development of symptoms, and then patients who had later, after 4 or 5 days, after developing the symptoms. Because certain viral, for many viral infections, early treatment is recommended. So we want to see whether the early treatment is having a place. So at the moment, we are doing a retrospective analysis of our data to see whether there is an effect like that. But at the moment, we are not doing a prospective study. Several other proposals have been submitted for ethical approval, and we might start some other trials. What has been shown is there's a big ventilatory perfusion mismatch in this condition, and that is being corrected in the prone position. And it is attributed to microvascular thrombosis in the pulmonary vasculature.
Thank you.
Any other question?
Veera Surya here from watching the session from Zoom. To me, the approval of hydroxychloroquine appeared a classic response of public panic and most of the regulators not being careful about the data and not talking to the population. The motto was, do something, even if doing nothing is better. At the moment, the Indian Council of Medical Research has approved further drugs, including monoclonal antibodies, without any of the data being revealed. So one suggestion for the team in the Ministry of Health is to treat any Indian Council of Medical Research decisions with extreme skepticism. And it goes also to show what we as clinical pharmacologists have kept on saying. One of the things is that it does take 1 year to treat medical students about a drug. It takes 3 years to teach doctors on when to use a drug, and it takes a lifetime to teach doctors when not to use a drug. So, evidence-based treatment, congratulations to the team in Sri Lanka. Using that motto, you have saved unnecessary harm to the patients with COVID. Thank you.
Any other questions? There was another. You asked, no? Kalyani?
Madam, they have used practically everything. So hydroxychloroquine, chloroquine, favipiravir, then the anti-retroviral combination, calatra, that is Lopinavir and Ritonavir, yeah, those. So many drugs. There's not just not one drug. And in most trials, the problem is they have given everything to everybody. So it's rather difficult to wean off and say this is the drug that is of benefit. And the data is not randomized and controlled in most cases. And sometimes it's observational, looking at two different populations and comparing them. So even the inclusions are different. So Chinese data is questionable in some instances. And in some cases, actually, we had instances where the original papers were withdrawn again by the Chinese government itself. There was one time frame where there was a blackout sort of thing from all the data that was coming from China. So the papers that we had looked at earlier were suddenly not accessible during that period. So Chinese data, again, is difficult to interpret. But they're actually sharing quite a lot compared to what they normally do.
It is said that immunity after natural infection is not persistent, and that a person who has got COVID-19 once can get another infection, unlike the other viral things like chickenpox and so forth. Now, in that light, what about the vaccine? If you could show the vaccine.
It's the same with dengue. You can get reinfection.
That's the thing. So, but we have, I mean, all over the world, they are spending so much on vaccines. But when I was very alarmed when I heard that, you know, after natural infection, you can get reinfection. From what I've read, if it is right in the newspapers.
So far, of course, there are some documented evidence that there have been reinfection. But as I mentioned, one of my questions, due to the lack of time, I didn't go through it. Now, other thing is whether antibodies are neutralizing antibodies. So there are neutralizing antibodies. So this disease is actually kind of only 8 months old. Now, human coronaviruses, of course, they have antibodies persisting beyond 6 months, 8 months. So we do not know whether antibody that is measured by either the neutralizing technique, whatever the technique, is not important for you all. But whether the antibody that is persisting is whether they are sufficient enough to prevent an infection. So far, there are more than 9 documented cases published in peer review journals. There are evidence that there are on France, USA, and of course, I do not know whether Chinese, whether they have published it as such. But more than the reinfections, madam, the publicized has been given, there's one slide in my presentation also, 212 re-positives of the PCR. PCR is being shed for more than 8 weeks, sometimes 12 weeks. PCR remnants are there in the respiratory. So that has been actually misinterpreted as reinfection, where we have also have 4 cases. Recently also been one from who came from Kuwait, and then of course she was actually said that as kind of a reinfection. But your point is so valid, because now just like the drugs or the therapeutic agent, perhaps billions are pumped into vaccines, and as Professor Chandanie quite correctly mentioned, one country is actually grabbing all the prospect, like billions of vaccines are procured before even it come into the market, kind of this thing, because of their power. So I think time will tell. You cannot speculate as such. I'm a virologist for almost 12 years now, but this is actually a novel infection. We do not know whether persistent antibodies will protect us, but definitely, like when the seroprevalence studies are more available, especially even in Sri Lanka, and most probably now we have all the records in IDH and other treating hospitals, and they have been told to report if there's, and so patients are also very much, I think in next, at least before the end of this calendar year, we will have a few answers, not all questions, at least few answers, particularly your question as well.
Yeah, can I ask a question from you, Ananda, or any of the others? Now, when you get dengue, we know that if you get a second attack, as far as I know, that can be more serious than the first attack. I'm not sure about COVID. I don't know whether you can answer that.
We don't know, madam.
Yes.
We don't know, because we don't know how these antibodies behave, or the first infection affects the memory, and how that affects the second infection.
If I may add, this dengue, of course, what is happening in the original antigenic scene. Because now when the dengue 1 is infected, and of course subsequently when the dengue 2 comes, the body actually remembers the dengue 1. And rather than the neutralizing antibodies, it will produce large number of dengue. When the dengue 2 comes, if the previous infection is dengue 1, there will be large amount of antibodies produced as dengue 1 rather than dengue 2. So that phenomenon is called original antigenic sin. So we do not know whether this again will actually have that kind of disease. But definitely, madam, it will be changed. Now, for instance, there are human coronavirus type 1, four types of 1. So what happened is the beta and alpha, there are two families also. But dengue, same family, type 4, and of course maybe the cosmopolitan one, only one subtype as well as, four serotypes are there, but very narrow down. So here, of course, what's happening in the virological, this is again going by very basics, not therapeutically and of course not followed up as such. So we do not know whether the subsequent infection will be high, but since because of respiratory viruses, rather than going into other capillaries and of course blocking renal capillaries and multi-organ failure, rather than going into the complexes, what we can speculate is chances are less. Again, time will only tell.
The cytokine storm, probably all those people who died may have developed the cytokine storm. Is there any way of predicting those who will develop it? Is those with other comorbidities, or can other healthy people also develop the cytokine storm, Ananda?
Yes, healthy people also can develop, but the people with other comorbidities, especially with the diabetes and hypertension, are more likely to develop these complications. And interestingly, one of the parameters they have used in other countries is the interleukin 6 levels, which is supposed to be going up in this. In fact, there had been some recommendations in some guidelines, if the interleukin levels are high, then to treat them with blockers, IL-6 blockers. But then we had some studies done where the interleukin levels were checked, and then when we compare the interleukin levels with patients we had dengue previously, those dengue patients had much higher interleukin levels even without having complications. So whether that is a good indicator of that is questionable. So there are concerns because of that. And also initially though a lot of people are talking about this cytokine storm, now more emphasis is given to this thrombosis theory.
A question to Dr. Jayamaha. Do you hear me?
Yes.
This question of how long the immunity lasts, Dr. Jayamaha, if we take the example of measles, when we get the measles vaccine, we know there is a reaction, and then after that, the antibody levels go down. 10 years after that, can we check that person to see whether that person is immune to measles or not? If we can check, how do we check? Is it on the antibodies? Or can the antibodies be very, very low, but there are memory cells, the T cells, which will very quickly activate on meeting the measles virus again? This is the sort of analogy I see in terms of a vaccine that we know. Can this analogy come about with the COVID vaccine is the question for which there is no answer at present. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that question. Measles, of course, have primary viremia and secondary viremia. And of course, they have during the secondary viremia, as you quite correctly mentioned, there are antibody. Of course, there are IgG antibodies, neutralizing antibodies, as well as other non-neutralizing antibodies. But here, because since it is a respiratory viruses, influenza also, we need to have, even the virus has not significantly changed because of the way that we actually inject. The way that the antigen presenting cells and the dendritic cells, of course, the presenting the lasting memory, even because now, even though the influenza vaccine is given time to time, we have a problem of producing antibodies and keeping this antibody. So that particular either measles mechanism of protection, even as we quite collect a mission 15 years even after the, of course, we had to give two doses, unlike the previous one dose, the lasting immunity is there. But of course, when if you apply in this context the COVID-19 or any other virus that has a respiratory, primary or respiratory route, the IgA and of course the respiratory secretions, thereby pooling into the blood, the protecting mechanisms may be different. So I think now, of course, the first kind of Oxford vaccine came, and then they are almost in the third trials, and they are giving into the community. They go, I think they are in the 3B. I think pharmacologist is there here, 3B, I guess. Yeah. So I think, sir, maybe. Of course, they need to follow. I think and Dr. Anthony Fauci made a great statement yesterday or day before yesterday that highly effective vaccine is unlikely even in 2021 summer or something. That's what he said. So again, it's of course skeptical. this is actually a theory or whatever known to another virus or a group virus we are actually trying to apply. But I think hope is, of course, what we are expecting here.
Just shows the lessons we learned from other viruses cannot be directly transferred to COVID. So as a result of that, we have to wait and see and to get the evidence and the data. Thank you.
We have just about 2 minutes, right, left? Can I ask a question from, I'm just talking from a public health point of view. This hydroxychloroquine drug, isn't it being misused by some unqualified doctors in the country? And how do we have a control on that? Ananda and Chandanie, both questions to both of you.
Yeah, I think as Chandanie mentioned in her talk, initially there was a lot of pressure on our clinical group to recommend prophylactic use of hydroxychloroquine. And I'm sure during that period, many people took hydroxychloroquine as prophylaxis without any recommendation. I know at least some doctors took, I know personally. But then there was no end to taking that. So I think they stopped taking that after some time. Presently, I don't know whether a lot of people are using or abusing it as a prophylactic measure. The wide availability of that has been restricted by NMRA. So even though it was abused earlier, I think now it is most likely less now.
No, that's nothing actually. Yes, Ananda is right. It's not really unqualified people. The problem was more with qualified people giving it. And because it's a prescription-only drug, it's scheduled to be. So therefore, it has to ideally be dispensed with a prescription. So if people are misusing, that is with an illegal or wrongly written prescription with very little evidence. So that's again, it boils down to what I said earlier also, that's your professional integrity that you are basically ruining with that.
Any other questions?
Got about 1 minute more. Really.
Yeah. Okay, so I think that we shall conclude this symposium. I think we have had three excellent presentations, and I hope that we are all talking about this vaccine, and I hope that very effective vaccine will be manufactured by someone. We heard about the Oxford group, we heard about various other countries trying to, manufacturing, the clinical trials are underway. So that is what we hope. So that I think we should be able to get back to our normal lives, and very important what Ananda mentioned about the fact that the public should be more careful and practice right, regarding the preventive measures to somehow or other combat this terrible infection.
Thank you very much to this great panel of distinguished speakers. They have done a wonderful job in this country in this time of the COVID infection. We are so grateful to you, and as a senior family physician, I am grateful to all three of you, the information you give us all the time, and also help all of us in decision making. Thank you very much, and I think the audience will totally appreciate what you all said. The facts and figures are extremely useful. So this whole session was very good. Great show. Dr. Ananda Wijewickrama, Professor Chandanie, and Dr. Jude. We'll meet again sometime.
And please acknowledge them in the usual manner. Thank you, Ananda.